A very good morning to you all. Good morning to our dear speakers and our students. Thank you so much for joining us today on the day one of the examination preparation workshop by the UNISA Directorate Counseling and Career Development of the Gauteng region. My name is Christy Vilendo. I'm a UNISA student mentor under the Ekurhuleni Regional Center, and I shall be your program director for today's workshop. Before we get into the matters of the day, I'd like to call on to our TCGP, our Trainee and Career Guidance Practitioner of the Johannesburg Regional Centre, Ms. Lehlohonolo Mahinga, to do the opening, the welcoming, and state the purpose of the day. Ms. Mahinga, over to you.
Thank you so much, colleague. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name, as mentioned, is Lehlohonolo Mahinga. On behalf of the UNISA Counseling Department, I'm thrilled to welcome you to day one of our exam prep workshop. Thank you all for taking time out of your schedules to join us today. I hope this workshop will be fruitful for everyone. The purpose of this workshop is to equip you with the necessary knowledge, skills, and strategies needed to do well in your upcoming exams. By joining this workshop today, you have already taken a positive step towards preparing for your exams. I encourage you all to engage fully and ask questions to ensure that you understand the content that will be presented today. And without further ado, I'd like to hand back to our program director. This workshop is officially opened. Thank you.
So for now, I'm going to call our first speaker, Ms. Martha Nyandeni, who's going to talk to us about the assessment matter. She's going to take us through the off-timetable modules and modules using continuous assessment type. Ms. Martha Nyandeni is one of the managers within the Department of Student Assessment and Administration, focusing on formative assessments. She works with the College of Agriculture and Environmental Sciences and the College of Science and Engineering Technology. She has been with UNISA for more than 10 years, and she's passionate about excellent service to the student and has presented in many activities on student orientation and exam preparation. She also offers administrative support to academics on assessments-related activities. Colleagues, please help me welcome Ms. Martha on the stage. Ms. Martha, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much once more, Chairperson. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the Directorate Counseling and Career Development, the Gauteng region, for giving us this opportunity to come and speak to our students and to prepare them for the upcoming October-November examination. It is my greatest pleasure to do this morning, but also to say to our students that what we are doing today is just one of the many other activities and information that is available to students as they prepare for their examination. I would urge the students to access our MyUNISA, where they will get more information about how students are being prepared for the examination, as well as we do have the ADOF, what we call the UNISA Academic Development Open Virtual Hub, which also offers sessions to students to help them navigate the online examination platform and also to give them other opportunities for them to get hands-on experience on the upcoming examination. And also, there are MOOCs as well, where the students can actually go into the system to practice the examination, as this will be very much helpful since we know that the online environment, although it has been with us for a while, but the students still get challenges, especially our first year students. So just to start my presentation, I'd just like to mention the important dates to you students. You know that within the university, the students, as students, you are being admitted to the examination. There are certain requirements that you need to meet in order for you to get access to the examination. And I assume that all the students that are here on the platform this morning because they received exam admissions for the modules that they registered for. We did run the program last week Friday on the 13th of September, and the program will run again tomorrow, the 20th September, to make sure that all the other students who had challenges with exam admission will be admitted to the examination. Also, I'd like to mention that as we are preparing for the examination, the formative phase of assessment needs to end, that is the submission of assignment, and the last day is the 30th of submission all the assignments, but only the ones that are on the timetable. As you'll see later on as I present that, we do have modules that are using the timetable exams and other modules that are using off-timetable exams and continuous assessment. And that is my focus of the presentation this morning. And then my colleague, Ms. Demudeja, will talk about the exams, the timetabled ones. And also the examination will commence on the 7th of October for the short learning programs, as well as the formal programs will start on the 14th of October. You will see that on your timetables. And then we will conclude our examinations on the 6th of December. And then the final date and the release of the results will be the 11th of December. Okay, now that examination admission has been done on the 13th and the other one coming, what you will expect on your side is that for the off-timetable modules, you will see that on your timetable, it will just be written departmental requirement. It's written departmental requirement because for the off-timetable, you already know what is required. And for those, it's the portfolio, the practical, as well as the project. But I will talk about them later. So that information is already on your module side, as well as on the tutorial letters. And also, you will know the due dates of your portfolios, as I said. That is all on the module side. So with the off-timetable modules, you don't get specific information because you already have that information. Hence, the timetable will just say departmental requirement. And then for your on-timetable modules, that is the examination, you will get timetables. They have been issued, and those ones will have the date and the time for each module. So check the exam rules posted with the timetables, and you must also confirm the proctoring tools that you going to use. The next speaker, Ms. Mandisa, will talk about proctoring, as we know that all our examinations are proctored. Okay, and then just before I talk about the off-timetable assessments and continuous assessment, you will be able to view all your marks for your assignments on the My Admin. If you go on the My Admin, the example of the screen that I've shown, you can be able to see all your assignments that you have already submitted, and you can also be able to view, to see when it was written and also the mark that you have obtained for your particular assignment. And also there on the view, the highlighted, unfortunately, it's supposed to be the marked files, but since we changed the system, you will get your marked files on your My Modules platform, as well as upon marking, you do get communication to get to say that your assignment has been marked. And as you go down there, you will see that it is the top part is formative assessment, and then the bottom one is on the summative, which is an examination. As you can see, this module CHE is an exam, and the platform is My Exam, and then there it shows the date on which it is written and the time, as well as when you click here on the year mark, you will see what is the year mark for your particular module. And note that it may be that some of the assignments are not yet marked, so you may find that the year mark that you see there is not your final mark, because the lecturers are currently finalizing the mark of all the assignments to make sure that you do get your assignment back and your marks as well. So that year mark, if it's not what you expect, don't be alarmed, because once the other assessments have been marked, then your full year mark will show. And then here, I just wanted to show you the two types. The exams, we call them summative assessment. Here, this student has got two exams. The other one is the one that I'm going to talk about, the portfolios, a practical, and the project, which are off-timetable modules. And then the student also has an online exam. So the online exam is the timetabled one. As you can see, GGH2604, the student will go to my exam, and then it's written on Tuesday the 26th, and there is the time. Same applies to GGH2603. So on your My Admin, you can be able to see this information concerning your assessment. And as I said, just be patient with the university. We know that you need your marked assignments and your marks as you prepare for the examination so that you know how to exert yourself, how hard you need to study, or maybe if your year mark is high, then maybe you know more or less what is required. So coming now to our summative exam preparation, it's for the off-timetable modules. We call them off-timetable modules because they are not timetabled. You will never get a timetable on these modules, but the information is there for you on the module side. So those ones, we're talking about the portfolios, we're talking about projects, we're talking about practical. For the portfolios, you will get on the module side an assessment that the questions that the lecturer will want you to do for your portfolio. Or the portfolio, you did get the instructions at the beginning of the year. For example, like the students that are doing education, those students, they do get their information where they have to go to the schools and to do their practical, and then after that they compile the portfolio. So that information is already available. It's just like your project as well. That information was communicated already because it takes a while to do your project, and then you find that at the end, when you submit a report, but the project is already done. Same applies to practicals. Maybe you have already been to the labs, or you have been to the various institutions like social work students. They've already been to the agencies to do their practical, and then they will do their report, and then they will submit it on the system under my modules. And then we also have work integrated learnings and scenario based as well, and also continuous assessment. So those are the off timetable modules. So when you see that, you shouldn't think that you don't have an exam. This is very important, students, because your final result is dependent on this piece of assessment. So if you didn't submit your portfolio, or you didn't submit your project, or you didn't submit your practical, you will be deemed as being absent from the examination. So make sure that you comply with the requirements as they have been communicated to you. And then, as I said, the due date, the opening is, and the assessment questions and on the module side or on the tutorial letter. So by now you should be knowing what your project is all about, your portfolio, and what is it that is required from you. And also note that there is no proctoring for portfolios, for practical, and for project, but what we call turn it in may be used. So what is turn it in? I think by now you already know about turn it in. You have used it with some of your assignments. So turn it in is a system that UNISA has in order to test your originality, the work of your originality as a student, and it promotes the integrity of the qualifications. So turn it in makes sure that you as a student, you use the references correctly, you don't copy from other students, you don't use ghost writing, you don't ask other people to write for you, because when they write for you and they don't know what is required, you may end up not referencing properly, and you know that the university is not kind to students when you use plagiarism, meaning that if you use somebody else's work, you have to acknowledge them through referencing that the lecturer would have explained to you on how it is used. So also with turn it in, the lecturer has to train you. They have to explain to you and give you information on how it works. So, and turn it in is integrated on the system. So you don't have to download it from anywhere. You just go onto the system, and at the point of submission on my modules, you will be asked to accept the EULA, what we call the End User Licensing Agreement. And then once you accept that, then the system will allow you to submit, and then your work will be taken to turn it in, and then turn it in will analyze your work, and then it will produce a report with the percentage, the usage percentage. Don't be alarmed by that percentage. It doesn't mean that it's a mark that you get. It is just the similarity that the tool has found in your work? Because as you write, you use references, you use books, you use articles. So Turnitin will identify those references and they will highlight it to say the student has used this and this and this. So it's not like it's not like something to scare you, and the lecturer should explain to you how Turnitin works. And also, students, please note that when you're using Turnitin, you can't submit scanned document. Even if when you write, you type, but the minute as you scan to submit, then Turnitin won't be able to read your document, and also no handwritten documents are submitted with Turnitin. Otherwise, Turnitin is not able to see your report and be able to read it. And I think some of the students have already received a message maybe to say report unavailable when they submitted using Turnitin. And that simply means that you submitted the document in the incorrect format and Turnitin is not able to read that. So coming to exam admission, by now you know the criteria that was used by your lecturer that was communicated to you earlier in the year. The use of one submitted assignment or a minimum number of assignment, maybe two or three or four, or some of the modules, but mostly for postgrad, they use a percentage, a year mark for you to write the exam. And then for continuous assessment, you were automatically admitted to the examination. Okay, then the submission platform, you already know it. It's MyUNISA. It's my modules, the one that you are currently using to submit your assignments. Then nothing has changed in that regard. Coming to continuous assessment. Continuous assessment is a type that we use whereby you will be asked to submit various assessments, a quiz or file upload, or sometimes you are will be asked to do tests as part of a continuous assessment. The engineering students, I think if you have any amongst you now, they are familiar with the test, they do test. And so with continuous assessment, we don't have a formal exam like the way we are referring to exam where you come in, you write a down, and then you submit or the portfolio. With continuous assessment, all your assignments that are given to you, they have a weight of a percentage and they will contribute all of them to your final results, to your result. And also with continuous assessment, you do have what we call electives, meaning that you can actually choose which assignment to do. If you are required to do three, maybe the system will only take two and two best. But if you have done the two, the system will only take that two. So with the electives, you are just given a chance as a student to try and improve on your mark because you are given various assessment. And it's up to you what which assessment you do, but it's always advisable to do all the assessments so that maybe you didn't perform well on your first assessment, but then you can improve on the coming assignment. So as I've already said, you may be required to use a test and the test will be proctored. Mandisa will talk about proctoring. You already know it as a UNISA student, already having started the year with us, you already have been exposed maybe to proctoring tools if you did do your May, June examination. And also with proctoring, if you didn't use it, your marks will be withheld, and there is an appeal process, but my colleagues will talk about it. If the information can be verified, then your marks will be released. But if you didn't use your proctoring tools, then it means that you didn't comply with the university requirement. And for continuous assessment, that's why there is an elective assignment. It's because there is no supplementary, no aggregate and FI, so you are given a chance for you to make sure that you pass. So marking and release of results after you submit, especially your portfolios and your practicals and your project, your report, then marking and moderation will be done after the assessment has been submitted, and you won't be able to see your marks, even if the marking can happen, even if maybe the portfolio was submitted earlier, because I know for education, the portfolios are sometimes submitted early in August, but the marks will only released finally at the end of the year when we release all the marks. And the marks of your portfolio and your project will be comprised of your year mark as well as your exam mark, that portfolio. Remember, I said it's an assessment piece, it's part of your exam, and it will be it will contribute towards your final mark. So refer to your tutorial letter, because each and every assignment has a weight, and also you know there is a weight to say your exam maybe contributes a 60% to the final mark, and then your year mark 40, or sometimes your year mark is 20% and then your exam mark is 80%, all of them to make 100. Okay, students, I think I've come almost to the end of my presentation, but these are the contact details. If you need assistance with your assignment or your portfolio, mark, whatever challenge you may be experiencing, you can send your emails to assign@unisa.ac.za. And also we have a student contact center, which is toll free, that you can contact anytime in order to send your inquiry and as far as your assessment is concerned. And that is the end. Thank you so much, Program Director. I hand over to you, and I would like to wish our student a successful examination as they prepare themselves, and I wish them the best. Thank you, Program Director.
Yes, I just wanted to ask you in terms of exam result. I've got a little bit of problem. I've been with UNISA for quite some time now. There is sometimes you write those continuous assessment or assignment. So you can see the result that from the beginning of that assignment until to the end of assignment, you never fail. You always pass your assignment very well. But at the end of the last continuous assessment, then you find out like you don't receive your mark. And then if you inquire at the exam department, so they would, whatever they will give you by that time, they will give you a fail exam, a fail result. So sometimes it's a little bit confused what is going on. Sometimes they will tell you that you didn't write exam. By the time you did, likely you can prove by putting out whatever, maybe short screen or whatever that you saved. And then when you give them, you present that, and then whatever they will give you, so they will go and search. We don't even know if they are searching or if they are looking for your marks that you work on it. But whatever they will give you is just a failed result. So we don't know what is going on. Can you please help us on that?
When it comes to continuous assessment, as I said, there is no formal examination the way we understand exams. But all your assignments, they do have a weight. And as you calculate your final result, you see what weight each assignment carries, and also the percentage that you have given, you have obtained. With continuous assessment and with the marks, there's no way that we can say you have failed if you have been passing all along. It's not maybe like an exam, because the exam, then you find that the contribution is higher. So, and you already know your marks. Like with continuous assessment, by the time you submit your final assignment, you already see whether you are passing or you are not passing. So I don't understand if you say that, and then when you get to the university, then somebody goes and checks on the computer, and then they come and fill and see and give a failed result. That is not usual, because whatever is on the system won't be changed. We don't just change a marks. If it has been released to you as a student and you have proof, you can query it, that inquiry, so that if it's not the case, then the marks can be corrected if there's a need for it. But it's very, it's not normal that we will change the student's marks. If you have passed, you have passed, and everything is reported on the system, and it's generated, and the final calculation of the marks are done on the system with what is already there. We are not allowed to change any marks, and there is an audit trail for anybody who changes a mark and need a memo and what. So we do have our internal control measures that we don't just allow anybody to go and change the student marks. So I think think you can send me your module code. I'll send my email address here, and then I will investigate it for you and that module to see exactly what happened there. Thank you.
I have a similar problem with the assignments for the MAT 1521 module. So on Sunday, we were given the notice that we were not getting our exam admittance. And when that happened, we sent an email to the lecturer. And the lecturer then said that it's a problem with carrying the marks over from an external platform onto my admin. So as ma'am has said before, that tomorrow is the last day for them to provide proper exam admittance. So my problem is, when I checked my admin this morning, only three of my assignments are reflecting instead of the six. What does this mean? I've contacted my lecturer. I haven't gotten back any feedback. What does this mean for my exam admittance?
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Luckily, I know about the maths issue because I work in the College of Engineering. There was an issue there whereby, as the lecturer has explained, that the marks were not transferred onto the student system because the criteria was a submission of an assignment. So the student's record didn't show any submission, but that has since been corrected. And tomorrow, when the exam admission is run, you will get an exam admission. All the students will be admitted.
Yes, but I have a problem. I'm only reflecting three assignments instead of my six assignments on my admin portal.
It means that the lecturer is still marking the other assignments.
So, which means that will come through at some point. But I'm just asking, if I've submitted three already, does that mean I will get exam admission?
Yes, you will get exam admission. Once I'm done with the questions, I will also go on to the system just to check the criteria, and then I will respond here on the chat. But you will get exam admission if you have submitted assignments.
I have a problem by tomorrow. Who can I contact about it?
Hello? I didn't get that.
If I do have a problem about it tomorrow, who can I contact about it?
You can send me an email. I did send my email address here, or you can send I'm also going to post the inquiries for assignments as well as exams. But Mr. Mudeka will also give you the inquiry mailbox for the exams. But you can send me an email, because luckily I work with the maths department, so I am aware of the challenge, but we are fixing it. And I'm happy to hear that you say that the marks have already already on your record, so it means that the system did transfer the marks, and exam admission will run smoothly tomorrow.
For now, we won't be taking hands. We're going to the next speaker, Ms. Masiza Mandisa, who's going to be talking to us about proctoring tools. Ms. Mandisa, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Chairperson. I've already mentioned my name is Mandisa Masiza. I'm coming from Proctoring Department in Vigilations. I'll be taking you through to the information this time. It's not going to be technical issues, but we can be answering technical issues later on the chat. There's two types of exempted students at UNISA: the incarcerated students and the differently abled students. These two categories must apply for exemption at examdisabled@unisa.ac.za, and their applications must be accompanied by supporting document. It could be a letter from the doctor, and or it could be a letter from the prison or correctional services. We have three types of proctoring tools. Except for the tenet in that Minyandin had already mentioned. On our department, we have three. We have the Moodle proctoring, the Iris, and the Invigilator app. Those are the most popular. Moodle proctoring speaks to the MCQs or the quiz modules for all colleges, except for College of Engineering and Technology. It is a built-in proctoring tool within Moodle. That one, you access it through Moodle. What you do, you just, as a student, you will just upload your picture. It's already there. You don't need to download it anyway. It requires a smart cell phone, laptop that is camera enabled. We're going to the Iris. When Iris is activated, it will record. You'll be recording a video of you captured through your computer's web camera. It will also be recording sound from your computer's microphone. Every few seconds, it will take a screenshot of whatever is showing on your computer screen. This means when it's activated correctly, there will be videos of you, whatever that is that you will be doing. When you're moving, when you're not moving, when you're looking sideways, it is a video. It will capture that those videos. It's a 10-minute video that will every time will be uploaded. And then it will also take pictures. We can be able to see what it is that we're doing in a certain picture. And then again, when you're talking to somebody, we can also be able to hear that through your microphone. All these things must be activated and allowed on your settings. Because if you're not, if your camera is not allowed, so we don't see you on your camera, you are going to be flagged for it. Students, take note of this. You are going to be flagged if your camera is not showing your face. Because we cannot be able to know who is writing behind the gray screen, the black screen, the green screen. Some of them come with colors. We'll be moving to the Invigilator app. It instructs students to take selfies, random microphone recordings of students' speech during exams, tag geolocation of students writing close proximity. Students can download Invigilator app from Google Play Store, Apple iStore, and Huawei Gallery using their smart cell phones. Now, it happens sometimes, I just want to mention this, it happens sometimes that you do not have a phone and you borrow a phone from your relative or your fellow students. Please make sure that you change the details to yours, because when we doing our reviews, it won't show that you've written the module. It will show a different student number, and it will show a different face, and it will show something else. And sometimes you will end up not even receiving your results. Please make sure that you change those details to yours if you are to borrow a phone from someone else, because we cannot tell if someone else was writing for you or what was happening. Please, students, we really are asking for you to be careful of that one. These are the colleges that use these proctoring tools. As you can see, Iris will be School of Engineering, Science, Engineering and Technology, Education, Accounting Science. Accounting Sciences for CTA exams and for the third year modules. Exiting modules for School of Accounting will be also using Iris, and the rest will be using Invigilator app and MCQs for Moodle proctoring in all colleges except for CSET, School of Engineering. Moodle proctoring, all MCQs examinations except CSET will be proctored by Moodle proctoring. I mentioned that. You must determine whether your module will be proctored by a Moodle proctoring tool. This tool requires access to a student's mobile or laptop camera. Student must ensure their camera is activated in their browser setting. Once a student starts their MCQ or quiz examination attempt on the My Exams platform, the student will be requested to activate their camera on the mobile or laptop browser. Once activated, the proctoring tool will work in the background with no further actions expected from the student. Should you not be doing what is being mentioned above, it means whatever is that is supposed to be done in the background won't work. And what happens is that at the end of the examination and the marking, we won't be able to see if you were using Moodle or not, because your pictures, this camera won't be taking your pictures. That it's just taking pictures. It won't be taking your pictures. And at the end of the day, it will be regarded as somebody who did not use the proctoring tool that is Moodle in this instance. So it is very important that all these steps above, you follow them through. Prepare yourself for Moodle proctoring by partaking in the mock examination. We can't emphasize this enough to students that before they go for their exams, it's very important that they go to these practicing sites so that you know now what is your problem, and then you can get help before that day. You can go to course Student 200 Basic Skills for Online Examination, section Lesson 7, Mock Exam. You can go there to prepare for Moodle proctoring. Non-usage of proctoring tools will result in students' marks being withheld unless exempted. Should you experience technical problems, call DCA Help Desk Line on 011-471-2433 or UNISA Contact Center on 0800-001870. Again, we need to emphasize this. When you seek help, do it in real time, colleagues. There are people who are sitting there who are to assist you in real time. Sending an email a week later to say, this is what happened when I was writing this particular module, it's kind of difficult for us to investigate your query and you get the results that you wish for. We're not saying we're not going to do it, but it's difficult because if we have this information that you tried to contact UNISA whilst you are struggling in real time when you are writing your exam, then it's easy for us to be able to go back to that information and see what we can do next. Now we're moving to the Invigilator app. Invigilator app functionality. It instructs students to take selfies. I mentioned random microphone checks, instructs students to take photo of ID document, prompt student to take photo of your answer sheet. I'm going to come back to the photo of your answer sheet. Upload answer script at the end of the session. However, it's very important to note that the primary platform for uploading is on My Exams platform. Whatever you upload on My Exam will be considered. If you upload an incorrect document on My Exam and a correct one on Invigilator app, the one on Invigilator app will not be considered. Let's go back to the photo of your answer sheet. Many students who have noticed that they fail the photo script check on their invigilation data. And somehow they did not even submit on My Exams. So this student, all the other things will check, selfies check, whatever else that is a data, it will check, but there's no script photo. So if there's no script photo, it means there's nothing to mark. And if you did not submit it on My Exam, it means there's nothing to mark. So what does it mean at the end of the day? It means that you'll be regarded as somebody who did not write your exam because there was nothing to mark. Again, the university is saying, when you're submitting on that primary platform, please submit something, the same thing that you are going to submit on the Invigilator app. So on the Invigilator, don't submit, let's say, a question paper on your My Exams, and then you submit an answer sheet on the Invigilator app and think that we are going to consider the answer sheet on the Invigilator app. We're going to first start on My Exams. What is that you submitted there? So at the end of the day, you're going to get a zero mark for submitting an incorrect document. You are going to be sent online exam rules, I think. I'm not sure when, but we are going to send them. This is very important to determine whether your module will be invigilated by the Invigilator app. Click on proctoring tools. In your communication, where there is proctoring tools, you click there, then you can be able to see which proctoring tool you use for which module, for the modules that you are writing. This invigilation tool requires students to download the app from their Play Stores. I already mentioned that, but a day before the examination sitting. Once downloaded, the student is expected to register using their My Life email address. I'm just going to come back to these two. On the day of the exam, the student is requested to scan the QR code that will be provided on the module site or on the examination question paper. Let me go back to the download part and the My Life email address. Students, please do not try and register on the day of your exam, because this will delay you in scanning the QR code on time. And when you do not scan that QR code on time, you are going to send a WhatsApp to that WhatsApp helpline for Invigilator app queries, and then you can't be assisted because you have passed your scanning time. And what happens is that at the end of the day, even if you can continue writing, if you do not, you are not proctored, then it means you didn't comply with the UNISA exam rules and your marks will be withheld. This whole download and registering must happen a day before your exam, please, so that you know on the day of the exam, what I'm going to do is just to scan my QR code. Everything else is there, it's fine. You'll find it on your module sites or on the exam question paper. Students are advised to obtain QR code in advance. Lecturers send it through 24 hours before exam. Having scanned the QR code, click on Access LMS on the top right of the app. The QR code is only available for activation 15 minutes before and 30 minutes after the scheduled start time of your examination. I just want to clarify this one. Let's say your exam is starting at 8 o'clock. You can start scanning your QR code from 7:45 to 8:30. It's 45 minutes. That is me simplifying this before and after, so that it doesn't confuse someone. 15 minutes before, that means 7:45. You are starting writing at 8 o'clock. You can still scan that QR code from 8 o'clock to 8:30. That is your 45 minutes. Then from 8:31, it closes. If you come back at 8:45 to scan the QR code, actually from 8:31 to scan the QR code, it's already closed. So there's nothing that one can do. Once you scan your QR code, ensure your phone is on flight mode. The Invigilator app will prompt students to partake in various activities. That is those those things that take a photo of your script, take this, take a selfie, all those things, those are those activities that will be prompted, some of them. Student must not close the Invigilator app as this will deactivate their app. Access the My Exam webpage on that link, click on the applicable module, then log in and access the question paper. After completing invigilation and following all app instructions, you must upload your data on the invigilation app and My Exam portal. I tried to explain that before. However, if there is a delay in the uploading of data on the app, you should prioritize the upload of your script on the university portal first. And later on, you can upload your data on the app as is no time sensitive. Now, remember on the My Exam, it will close at some point, but here you still have 48 hours on the app to upload your data. But for the script, you must upload it before the closing time of the exam. If the exam is 2 hours from 8 to 10, so it will close after 10:30, or by 10:30 it closes. If it's a take home exam, it will close 10:30. And then if it closes, it closes. So it's important that your script is there before that 10:30. On the Invigilator app, you can still come back. You still have 48 hours to upload your data. That includes your script photos. Not the script, but your script photos. While uploading your script to the exam portal, you can temporarily minimize the app. Students must finalize their upload of Invigilator scripts within 48 hours. I already mentioned that. Failure to upload your assessment will result in your results being withheld and will be deemed to have transgressed the exam rules. Students are GPS flagged when they write in close proximity to each other. Students will be flagged for out of app time each time they minimize the app or switch to WhatsApp, emails, messages during the exam. I think this one is very important because most of the marks are withheld for this particular instruction. Students, anything that is where you are out of app for more than 10 minutes, you won't get your results, right? You'll be flagged for being out of app. What causes this out of app is when you minimize the app or you switch off to your WhatsApp or to your emails or answering a call. No listening to music while writing an exam. That one is no longer applicable. That's why I just skipped. Then we're going to Iris. Iris Invigilation is a software program that helps provide UNISA staff with assurance and assessment integrity during online and remote assessments. Iris records audio, video, and computer screens activity for the duration of a test or an exam. It analyzes information using machine learning and automatically flags potential academic dishonesty. When Iris is active, it will be recording a video of you captured through your computer's web camera. It will also be recording sound from your computer's microphone. Every few seconds, it will take a screenshot of whatever is showing on your computer screen. How to install, you go to that link. This is specification of a laptop that is compatible for Iris, because you'll find out sometimes you will get a message saying, this laptop is not compatible for Iris. So you need in a minimum requirements will be Windows operating system, Windows 8 RAM, 4 gigabytes, hard drive space is 150 megabytes. That one is a minimum requirement. Then IRIS recommended requirements is Windows operating Windows 10, RAM is 8 GB plus, hard drive space 200 MB plus, Chrome Edge version latest release. These are the specifications. Student need connectivity at the start towards and towards the end of the session. You don't need connectivity whilst you are writing, but when you are starting, so that you can be able to download your question paper and do all these things to connect to IRIS, and then again when you are uploading at the end. Laptop or desktop, external or inbuilt microphone, no headset. Web camera, check that the browser can access your webcam and microphone using the below link. Taking assessment using IRIS tools. Study assessment, preferred browser is Google Chrome. It is a preferred browser. Navigate to the My Exam platform. Log in with your My UNISA username and password. Click on your exam link. Choose your exam module tab. Then click on online assessment or e-assessment. For online assessment, IRIS will pop up as soon as you have clicked on online assessment. For e-assessments, that is take-home exams, IRIS will pop up when you open the exam after you have clicked on e-assessment. Follow the IRIS instructions carefully. Start your exam and wait for IRIS upload when you are done. The issue here is always IRIS not popping up, IRIS not popping up. And it always goes back to the download, and is everything, every step was followed correctly? Was it done correctly? And sometimes it's a network issue. It can be a lot of reasons, but we won't know until you give us a call and we can take you through that process. Monitoring uploads. An upload manager for IRIS allows students to manage their uploads more effectively. This feature is especially useful for users who experience intermittent, slow internet speeds or connectivity issues during their exams. Students can access the Manage Uploads button on the bottom left of the invigilation window. With the new version of IRIS Invigilation, you can pause and resume your uploads at any time without losing any data or compromising the integrity of your examination. Monitor the progress and status of your uploads and get notified when they are completed successfully or if there are any errors or issues. Review and verify your uploaded files and make sure they match the requirements and expectations of the university. To access the new version of IRIS Invigilation, you will need to update your software to the latest version. This should occur automatically, but if you want to force the update, then please uninstall and reinstall the extension. We recommend that you do this as soon as possible before your next scheduled invigilated assessment. I believe that this session is recorded, so you can just click there to go through all these steps on how to do your uploads. This one is just there. It you'll follow through. It's clear. Very important. Queries that are beyond UNISA's control, including the following: personal network or service provider issues, load shedding, limited space on personal computer, crashed computer, non-functioning cameras or web cameras, using work computers that block access to the My Exam site, employer firework challenges, unlicensed software, e.g. license expires during examination. Postgraduate students experiencing the above challenges are advised to apply for an accredited and submit supporting evidence within 10 days of the examination session. Students will not be able to apply for an accredited for a third examination opportunity. Postgraduate or undergraduate students experiencing the above challenges in their second examination opportunity will have to re-register for the affected module. I think I have come to the end of my presentation, but how to contact us, help desk 011-471-2433. And the WhatsApp screenshot only for Invigilator app is 073-505-8273 or email proctoringenquiries@unisa.ac.za. And that will be the end of my presentation. Good luck to all students who will be taking their exam in the next coming exam period. Thank you so much. Thank you, Chair.
So there's a question from Sikumalo that says, I downloaded an Invigilator app, but it didn't allow me as the error message occurs saying email not verified with university. Please advise on this one.
Okay. Okay. It might be two reasons that we need to verify your email or your module is not proctored using an Invigilator app. Sometimes it does give that error for the Invigilator app students. If your module will be proctored maybe by Moodle proctoring or any other proctoring tool, but not Invigilator app, it will give you that, or else it's something that needs to be verified, then you will need to call our contact center at 0800, that's 0800 number. Sorry, I don't know it by heart, but I'll try and copy it and send it to the chat. Sorry about that.
All right, thank you so much, Ms. Mandisa. And the last question for now from Promise Maluleke, which says, what kind of details do you mean we should change when using other people's devices to write the exam? I think this your takes us back to what you had mentioned earlier. Pardon?
Yes. You must change to your name, your email address, your selfie, take your own selfie, because remember, it's already installed in somebody else's selfie, student number, and then the my life email address. So you must change everything to your details, so that the selfie is not showing the other face, and then the student number is showing something different, and the pictures, the ID is something different, so that we know that this person is the same person from the selfie to the student number. Because remember, when you're registering, you are taking a selfie, right? And when you're taking that selfie, it's installed there. So when you are taking somebody else's stuff, the selfie that you are going to get is someone else's, not yours. So you need to change everything and take your own selfie using their phone. And when you're done, you can just delete your information.
Moving on, students, we are now on the fourth item of the day. And our next speaker is Mr. Renster Modiha, who is going to talk to us about the exam matters.
My name is Renster Modiha. I'm working in the Directorate Student Assessment, Admin Assessment Manager. And then I proud myself with the 20 that I've been in this position. And we deal with anything that is the enforcing of assessment policies from the assessment procedural manual that goes across the formative and the summative, and then that of ensuring that our colleagues or our students are getting their results at the end of the day and they're being assisted where necessary when it comes to post results processes. Right, I've already spoken to you about the formative assessment, and I'll only be dwelling much on the summative assessment, which is traditionally known as examination, and then that is normally in a form of portfolio, the practical assessments, and then the platform wherein all of that is taking place is my exams and take home and essays or MCQs. As you all know, that on the 13th of September, we effectively run the admission program. And then the running of that admission program only didn't start with running of admission program. We've also ensured that we compiled the timetable. And the timetable had been compiled, and we've successfully run the admission program on the 13th. Important, please listen very carefully. There are those of you that their assignments are still due, or their assignments have only due recently, that is after the 13th, will not close the gate. We will be accommodating you still. And how are we going to accommodate you? We are going to run another admission program tomorrow on the 20th. And then that's where you'll get admission on all that you have submitted. And only after that, then you can complain that you are not having an admission on the module that you have actually submitted everything. Right, individual examination timetable letters are also available to students on MyUNISA as we are talking. And not only timetable, colleagues, we have also shared with you the examination rules and links. Links in as to where to, when to, and what to. The examination timetable and letters and several links for further information, e.g. Student Communication Service Center, SCSC. Their telephone number is also being shared there. And then your step-to-step guide for successful online examinations. Just to reiterate, and please believe you in me, if you can go and familiarize yourself with the rules, familiarize yourself with everything that has been sent to you as a way of preparing you to the examination, you are definitely not going to have any challenges, and it's going to have a very smooth sailing. Right, we are also saying that in terms of the platforms I've already alluded to, the take-home file upload, an essay type answering, the randomized MCQs, your timetable should be able to tell you in as to what kind of examination are you going to write. If it's a portfolio, then you'll get the days and time on the announcement. If it's a written examination, then the date will the timetable will actually be telling you when are you going to write that particular module. The individual assessment numbers, assessment number like you have had on formatives, where you are having assignment one or two or three, and when it comes to the actual examination or the final assessment, it will either be 94 or 95, and that have been communicated to you as per the assessment plan. Mantis have already taken you through about the Invigilator app, which all take homes and file upload does actually use, and then the IRIS proctoring that is normally used by CSET and KAIS, and the Moodle, which is used by the all the MCQs. Important, colleagues, if you do not use the Invigilator app, your results will not be released, and the description on the results letter will tell us such. If you do not use the proctoring tool, and there's supplementary for that particular module, supplementary will be granted, but the results will not be released. Should it be that it was on your second attempt, then your results reflect as saying a script rejected, and please re-register the modules thereon. The religious objections and special needs, remember, colleagues, that some of our modules are being scheduled on Saturdays, and we know that some of us are Christians, you know, some of us have got some religious obligations on those Saturdays. We do not close the door on your faith. We are saying that please apply to us in writing to say that you will not be able to write because of those religious obligations, and then please do so on or before the 31st, which have just passed. But should it be that you're still having 7 working days, you can still apply for that before the writing date of the examination. And we are appealing that colleagues, as and when they're having those challenges, they must actually do so by writing to us. And then special needs students, should it be that you're involved in an accident or any unforeseen have happened to your health and you feel that you need extra time, you can still do that by applying, and still 7 days is applicable, and ensure that a complete report is sent to this email address as shared, examdisability@unisa.ac.za, for us to be able to meet you halfway, ensure that you get assisted as per the recommendation of the medical practitioner. Our important dates, the examination admission, like I've said, it have actually ran on the 13th and will be running another one tomorrow on the 20th to accommodate those that the assignments have due after the 13th. And our exams will be starting on the 7th of October, and we will start our staggered release on the 4th of November. What do we mean by staggered release? We mean where lecturers have finished marking, will then be releasing those modules upon them finishing marking and all that needs to be done from their side. And the last day for the examination will be the 29th of November. And we are anticipating that we'll release all our results on the 19th of December. And we know and understand that our ever hardworking academics will assist in ensuring that this gets realized. And once 98% of our results are being released, for students that are left with one or two modules to complete their qualification, which is FI concession, will run the program and they will get to know in as to whether they qualify for that or not. Important, you need not to apply for that. Remember, you qualify automatically if you are left with one or two, and not only one or two, but also meeting other criterions like having had 30% as a final mark for that module, and then it not being a continuous as part of the condition, not only continuous, but also the portfolios. The closing date for remarks, for those that feel that they might have done better, will be the 31st of January 2025. The number of examination opportunities, please remember this, that for all modules that supplementary is applicable, if the coming examination is your first examination and should you not be able to write it due to unforeseen circumstances, please don't stress. You'll be given another opportunity to be written next year, May, June. You need not to re-register the module. But for the year modules where supplementary is applicable and you are not able to write now, please proceed in applying for an AgroTET, not later than 10 working days after the writing date. And then you will then be responded to and give you the date for January, February examination. And please remember that UNISA does not grant set opportunities. For those that are on a third opportunity needs to re-register. What do I mean by third opportunity? I mean those of you that have had the first opportunity in the previous May, June, this will be regarded as second opportunity, and should you not be able to write, it being postgraduate, you don't qualify for a supplement for AgroTET, it being undergraduate, it being the second attempt, you don't qualify for a third opportunity. Right, no application for such will be considered after the release of the results. Remember, I've said 10 working days after the writing date is a closing date for the AgroTET. Right, I've already spoken about the portfolio evidence, evidence-based assessment, continuous assessment, practical assessment, experimental assessment, and research. These kinds of assessment that I've just alluded to do not have supplementary. If you are writing a portfolio and you have missed the date to submit the portfolio, please proceed and make peace with it. Proceed in re-registering because you will not be granted another opportunity. Remarking or purchasing of examination scripts as part of our post-results processes will open immediately after the release of the results. And remember, for remarking, you should have obtained between 35 and 49%. For distinction reasons, you should be, should have obtained 68 and 74% in a study unit. And please proceed in doing that by sending your email to remark@unisa.ac.za should you qualify on the criterion that I've just alluded to. And should you feel that you need to purchase your examination scripts, please send your email to purchase script@unisa.ac.za. That is in line with Access to Information Act 2 of 2000, and you should be able to get that service, and your script will be delivered to your My Life email address. Remember, we don't use Gmails. It will be sent to your My Life email address as a contracted communication email address with us. Right, we are also having the general email addresses that is to be used as in when you are having inquiries. If you've got a general assessment related inquiry, send your email to exams@unisa.ac.za, and for purchasing, as I've already alluded, as purchase script at unisa.ac.za, and for remarking, it will be remark@unisa.ac.za. Remember what I've just said, there is a criterion you need to qualify for that criterion before you apply for remark. And religious students, it's only meant for those students that could not write on a particular Saturday as allocated because of religious reasons. And please send us a letter from your church, which is authentic, stamped, and for us to be able to accommodate you. And those that might be involved in accidents or be involved in a temporary disability, please do so by applying to us not later than 7 working days at exams disability@unisa.ac.za for us to be able to assist you before 7 days of the writing date, and then proctoring that one of Mandisa and that one of assignments. Colleagues, as I'm just about to conclude, let me thank you and submit, and then wish you all of the luck in this coming examination, as we wish to see you in the graduation date when you have actually finished and met all the requirements for your prospective qualifications. Thank you very much. Let me pause and submit to you, Chair, and thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you so much, Mr. Modiga, for the wonderful presentation on exam matters. Students, let's give Mr. Modiga a round of applause. And I would like to apologize, to send my sincere apologies to our students for not being able to see Mr. Modiga's presentation, as he had some technical challenges on his side. And we'd also like to take this opportunity to ask, to request Mr. Modiga to send his presentation to the DCCD team so we can then share it to our students since they were not able to see you. Thank you once again. Thank you. Students, I'm going to take questions for Mr. Modiga. I noticed that some of you, your hands have been up since the previous speaker. But for now, I'll just take questions that are related to the exam matters as presented by Mr. Modiga. And we will have the Q&A session after our last speaker has presented. Please be patient. So if your question is related to Mr. Modiga, leave your hands up. And if it's not, if it's related to the previous speakers, please put your hands down. Thank you. So the hand is from, thank you so much, students. Sipo, you can unmute your mic and ask your question.
Oh, thank you, guys. What I want to know, guys, I haven't received a clear response. Okay, I've asked this question on one of my lecturers to say, will the exams be an open or closed book exam, since I'll be taking the exam from home? So I haven't got a clear answer with regards to that.
Sipo, thanks for your question. What happens is that on your question paper, the kind of examination that you'll be writing, it is very clear on instructions in as to whether the paper is open book or no open book. Open book, that's where your lecturer would actually have some other references that has to be checked during the examination, and that should be permitted on the, you'll see that instruction on a question paper. But under normal circumstances, writing home or writing anyway, we are expecting you to be people of integrity. It's not an open book. If it's not said, it's an open book. So you know, we're not expecting you to be open your books, because that will be purported to be plagiarism, and then you might be on the wrong side of the university's policies.
Reconfirm. I've heard speakers say that if we fail the opportunity of the exam this year, mm-hmm. there will be a second opportunity next year mm-hmm. for an undergrad. Mm-hmm. Is that correct? Without re-registration?
Mr. Modifa?
Let me qualify that, and thanks for the question. Where supplementary is applicable, the modules that are having supplementary, if it happens that you have registered in the second semester, and this is going to be your first attempt, should you not fail, should you not write the examination, meaning you are absent, should you fail the module, then you'll be given another opportunity next year. But it's only for module where supplementary is applicable. Thank you.
I wanted to ask, Mr. Modoir, you spoke about purchasing of the script. Purchasing means, I'm understanding, is I buy something. And how much is buying my script from the university? And what are the reasons that the university now wants to sell my script back to me? Thank you.
The purchasing of scripts is 60 rands. And the reason why we want you to purchase it is that you know that this day and era, the access to information, it can be very, you know, the can be very dangerous, and then we want to ensure that we have given the script to the right person, and there's a process that we are engaging on in ensuring that we send that script to you. That is why it has got a price on it. That is, when you want your examination script, you are going to buy it. It is not something that UNISA have decided on its own. It's something that have been decided as per the Act 2 of 2000, Access to Information Act, and we are only but following the law on that one, and those are the reasons that I can actually put forward. Thank you.
I wanted to ask about the results, so not the results, the exam timetable, because we did receive the timetable, but then we do not have dates. So do we have to wait for the dates, because there's going to be a second round of admission for exams? Is it then going to be included on the second round, or how are we supposed to know when are we writing? That is the second question for me. Another one, it was already replied by Mr. Modiha when he was explaining the fact that there is going to be a second round, because there was one module I was not admitted to, but the assignment was only due yesterday. So I was about to ask that if they're saying I'm not qualified, but then they still open for assignment, what then are we supposed to do? But I think that was addressed already. So those are the two questions for me. The dates for us to write, are they going to be displayed on the timetable? Or how are we going to find out when are we writing? And the second question is the presentation. For us, for it to be presented or submitted, for us to have a view on it. And another thing, I think the last one would be that regarding the Invigilator, is it Invigilator app, I think? You mentioned something about not having to view your results. I just wanted to understand how is that supposed to be when you do not have that app? Or when you do have that app, can't you view it on your UNISA profile? Is it only when you have an Invigilator app that you can be able to access your results? Because it is very draining, because you keep asking, but no one comes back to you when you're doing it through emails. So I think this platform, if maybe you can get the direct contacts or emails for people, if we're experiencing such problems, we can be able to reach out to.
In terms of the timetable, Akona, where it says module arrangement on your timetable, it then means that you must go to your module announcements. Then you will see as to when that particular portfolio is going to open and when it's going to close. But under a normal cloud on written examination, all the examination dates are out. The entire timetable for October, November have been approved. have been finalized, but the only time that you do not see any date and time on a timetable, it means it's module arrangement, then go to module announcement, you should be able to get the date and time. And in terms of viewing the results, if the what I meant by saying that if you do not use the Invigilator app to the latter, meaning you do not do or strongly adhere to the examination rules, your examination results will be withheld because you either have been out of the app for 10 minutes or you were out of the app for a particular amount of time, which it is against the university rules, then therefore we are not going to be able to release your results. But an assurance that I can give those that might be having technical glitches when they are writing examination or being out of the app and not being a doing of their own, should it be that it's first opportunity and the module have got supplementary, then you'll still be granted supplementary to be written next year in May, June. If I've answered your corner, then all is fine. Bye-bye.
Moving on, our next speaker is Mr. Pete Mokobedi, and he is going to talk to us about disciplinary matters.
My name is Pete Mokobedi. I'm with the student disciplinary. I've been there for a number of years, even with the university and other universities subsequently. The aim of the student disciplinary is not punitive, like other students will say. The reason why am I emphasizing is not punitive is because of the following. And why do I say that? It's because how do we get hold, how are we made aware of a disciplinary case? The first one is direct or over the counter. The second one is telecom or email, whistleblowing, and the normal one, which is through academic department by the primary lecturer or the lecturers through the department. At the student disciplinary office at UNISA, we are guided by the university's policies, and one of them being the student disciplinary code. What is the aim of the code? It is to uphold the name and reputation of the university, maintain order, safety and security, and discipline, ensuring the integrity of the academic processes and assuring the quality of the assessment process. This, the latter, is very important because remember, when the university is peer reviewed, the quality of the assessment and the processes and the outcome is very important because it determines the value, the quality, the strength, and how it's perceived by its peers and the outside world. Any conduct student which contravenes of the student disciplinary code and negatively impacts the goals may be regarded as a misconduct and be subjected to disciplinary measures. The general supervision and control of student discipline at the university rests with the registrar. Steps to take, who to contact. The emails of my colleagues are indicated for noting, though I will be sharing also the slide. Or you can go over the counter at any of the UNISA centers or departments via email and whistleblowing as indicated previously. Process and procedure, you inform the student of college or department. The core issue is the assessment procedure manual and what if the query relates to first or second year module. If it's a DC related, and a report or a warning letter will be sent. But remember, it's only based on the severity of the transgression. Should they accept the warning letter, if it's granted, they were given a chance to re-register. But on emphasis as well, remember when you get a DC after your exams, you are given, there is an announcement that indicates that a student, whilst waiting for the finalization of a DC, because it takes a reasonable time, the student is allowed to re-register, but there might be consequences. The student must be aware. Should a student reject, then they go for formal disciplinary hearing. And when should they be found guilty, they might want the outcome because it's not predetermined. If the student is successful, the result might be released, or they might be given a warning and the cancellation of the module and the results, or they may be suspended for a number of years, from 1 year to 5 years, which is the maximum at the university. For third and fourth year modules, possibilities are that they will be sent for a hearing, even so depending on the amount of transgression on their paper or submission. A repeat offender is considered for disciplinary hearing because what is a repeat offender, just basically or generally? You are a student in your assignment, you are given a warning, and the warning is noted. And the formal, that is like a rehabilitative purposes to say, student, do not repeat such behavior because it might or may constitute too serious. And sometimes in the same module, in the formal assessment or final assessment, should you repeat, you are regarded as a repeat offender. And the repeat offender might be in one module, and then in another one, you repeat the same offense. Sometimes if you, let's say for 2023, you were given a warning, you repeat another of a different offense in 2024. You are still a repeat offender because you are showing signs of non-rehabilitativeness, whereby you are not, you cannot be rehabilitated, but you are now taken through the formal university process of a disciplinary hearing. And what does it mean to have a DP? It basically means that there are alleged irregularities found in your either answer or submission to the university formally for grading. That might be in an assignment, that might be in an exam. Either you may have been through the proctoring tools, as the colleagues have already indicated, you were discussing, and there are voices that indicate that there was a discussion or talking during an exam. Remember, venue-based rules apply to online. But the colleagues, I think they've clarified that further. Use of AI or improper referencing, which the script is sent to student disciplinary for further investigation. What happens during a hearing? After you've been identified, you are notified, evidence of your transgression is sent to you, you are invited for a formal disciplinary hearing. There's an ad hoc committee for hearing of cases. The evidence will be presented, then there will be a student disciplinary code, and where the student either, sorry for the background, for my colleagues, when you get to the hearing is virtual. There's no physical attendance, one. Two, or you might opt to make a paper submission to the hearing. Students are allowed to seek representation. And what kind of representation can a student have? You can have a fellow student representing you, an employee of the university to represent you, or a member of the SRC. Remember, kindly note, which is very important, no external legal representation is allowed at this stage, because remember, it's an internal process that is handled internally and has to follow internal mechanism processes and university procedures. I've already indicated, once you're found, once you're suspended, you'll be given a formal letter of suspension via your My Life email, where it will be indicated the duration and the module suspended, and you are suspended at the university, and it applies throughout all the other universities due to the fact that when you go for another institution of higher learning, you have to produce your result and your certificate of conduct, or they will request it, And sometimes if you don't disclose, they find it out at the other institution, you'll be further subjected to non-disclosure and whatever appropriate steps the institutions may take. After the first formal disciplinary has been initiated, a student is allowed a process of appeal. Now, in the process of appeal, it's not hearing the matter de novo, but the focus is on two things. Either the sanction is too harsh, where the student indicate or submit reasons as to why, or secondly, the process that was unfolding, they regarded the procedure was not fair, and they have to be submitting. So in the appeal, we do not start the matter afresh or de novo as it's known. And then the Student Disciplinary Appeals Committee, after listening to the student and after listening, going through all the submissions they made, either opt to keep the suspension, temper with the suspension, or increase it. So remember, when you go for an appeal, it doesn't mean that either it will be kept or reduced. It might even be increased. So it must be known that it's a thing, it's a part of the process that can happen. Why is the Student Disciplinary Office going through the process and subjecting the students through that? Is to uphold the name and reputation of the university, maintaining order, discipline, safety, and security at the university, adhering to university rules, policies, and regulations, ensuring the integrity of the academic process of the university, assuring the quality of the assessment process at the university, ensuring that the university produces the best candidate in any field of study, that when subjected to a working environment, you've performed to the best of your abilities as a result of the learning you went through at the university. Misconduct. These are some of them, but not exhaustive. You may go, some of them are contained in the university rules, but these are the main focus. It might be harassment. Harassment takes many forms. Some students harass administrative and academic departments when they, you know, using unsavory language, making threats. That is also harassment. Sexual harassment. I think we are familiar with sexual harassment and how it operates and goes about. Plagiarism, submission of own work and assessment that was copied, reproduced from another student, dishonesty while being assessed to mislead the examiner and the outcome of the university. Misrepresentation of false information, fraudulent qualification. We get a lot of those students get into university admission and further claim they done one or two modules or qualifications that either they did, but not to the extent that they present to the university. It's a very serious misconduct, examination irregularities. This one normally because we are online, we see it through proctoring tools by listening to the recordings, the iris, the module, where undue material going through unauthorized websites and so forth. Ghostwriting or making use of service providers. When students sometimes fall into the trap of getting somebody to write to them, and once the university gets wind or through the proctoring tool that we use, we realize that this was not the student writing, it lands you in serious trouble. Fraud. And AI. AI is a very common new trend that is taking everybody. And though the university is busy finalizing the formal policy on AI, the proctoring tools like Turnitin, as the previous colleagues have said, Similarity Script from the Invigilator app and all the other, the Iris and the Moodle, is a very serious. Remember, AI, it's not the we the aim of the student being tested is to find out their understanding, knowledge, and the output of material. But when you use AI, it's no longer your original writing and output, but you are using an external. So you are what you are misleading, because it's not your understanding and it's not what you can produce. The process and procedure, how it's done, the ad hoc committee, like I indicated, it based on the nature and extent, materiality of the plagiarism, determining extent, student level, challenges we face, leakage of students' information within the university. Remember, we are as AI and, you know, you being online formally, there's a lot of leakage, there's a lot of, you know, scamming, there's a lot of external forces that are always trying to hack the university system in order to gain access and misrepresent themselves as if they were formally part of the university processes. External service provider not approved or recognized by UNISA, not in line with the scope of teaching provided by the university. Sometimes we've bottlenecked with the internal process. Remember, though painful and hard, the university must follow its own rules, policies, and procedures, because once a matter is taken outside, the first question that the courts of law ask the university, did we follow our own processes, procedures, and guidelines? So that is why we use this the term of reasonable time frame to conclude a matter. Not receiving or being provided with enough or sufficient evidence to finalize a matter. Sometimes we have to do further investigation, and, you know, because it is there, we must finalize it. Everything relies on evidence. Evidence is the core and the center of everything. When a student submits rebuffing to rebut allegations, it's evidence. Clear referencing of plagiarism and identical work. We refer to the tutorial letters because those are the guidelines. Lecturers testify at formal disciplinary hearings because they are the custodians, the Turnitin report. AI in various forms. The university accesses AI in various forms to determine and chart a way forward. And then we use it as well in all our proctoring tools to try and detect, because we want originality and produce quality students. Thank you. I think I've come to the end of my presentation, Chair.
My question, ma'am, it's directed to Mr. Pitt, is regarding AI. Now, as a postgrad student, we do a lot of writing and we don't use AI. But what is happening is that Grammarly is being flagged as AI. Is there a way that UNISA can try and find a way of saying, picking up that the student was merely using Grammarly to correct where I may have written, wanted to say English, then I wrote English, therefore Grammarly is highlighting that, and then I choose the option of then correcting the word. Is it possible for the UNISA to relook at Grammarly perhaps and try and find a way of either excluding it as part of AI or flagging it and showing that it was actually the Grammarly and not the other parts of AI? Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for your question. But that's part of the content will be covered by one of our speakers tomorrow. She's going to talk to us about the ChatGPT, the use of, you know, AI apps when it comes to academics.
I'm writing an open book exam. It has been confirmed by the lecturer. It's a postgrad A degree. So I will be writing some of my pointers or guidelines on the post-it notepads, and I'm going to stick them on the wall. So I will be referring to the sticky notes throughout my exam. Would this not be considered as cheating when I keep on looking around on my wall?
Okay, can you please repeat your question, Teboho?
Okay, I'm saying that I'm going to be writing some of the pointers or the guidelines in terms of the pages that I will be referring to when writing an exam. So I will be looking around on the wall as I'm writing. So my question is, as I'm looking around on the wall, would that not be considered as me looking maybe at a person? Is it not going to be considered as cheating? That's my question.
Okay. Thanks, Mandisa.
No, there's nothing there in her question that suggests that she is cheating, because she's explaining what she's doing. When we are reviewing, there are things that we penalize and there are things that we don't penalize. But if we suspect that whilst you are looking on the wall, there's something maybe that you are reading at, I don't know, or you're talking to someone that we can't see on the video, then what happens, we can just write to the lecturer to say, please check the script of this person. Then the lecturer, understanding the content of this exam, then will be able to detect if the student was indeed copying from something or someone. I don't know. But from our side, it's something that we cannot say we can penalize it until we can see that this is too much looking on the wall this time. I don't know if you are answered, but yeah, I think that's basically it.
All right, so there's a question here on the chat regarding the proctoring tools. The question is from NS. The UNISA website, and it reads as follows, rather. The UNISA website does not indicate the proctoring tool for PRAC01W. Could you kindly indicate what proctoring tool we'll be using? Ms. Mandisa?
To find out which proctoring tool one is using, you can get that from the timetable on my exams, or you communication from UNISA, you go to proctoring tools and you click there and you just type in your module and it will show which proctoring tool you're using.
My question is to Ms. Mandisa. I noticed that when I was doing my assessment quiz, I don't know if it was a network problem or what, but it kept on freezing and the time froze. And when the time froze, there was a pop-up message that said, do you want to leave the page or do you want to wait? And I kept on clicking on wait. And then after a few seconds, it came back into motion and the timer started counting again where it left off. But now my concern is, does it affect anything to do with the assessment, or will it affect the assessment? Because even the camera, it disappears. I can't see my portraits picture on the side where it appears when I begin doing my Moodle proctoring. So I wanted to know if, does it affect my testing, or will it affect me being tested during the process of being frozen like that?
Yeah, when it comes to Moodle proctoring, it's ICT. It's an ICT system because it's on Moodle. So most of these questions can be directed to ICT staff, but I am going to get a contact person and I'm going to share it on the chat where you can be able to ask your questions regarding the Moodle proctoring. But what I know is that even if a system can freeze, if you have already answered certain questions, it saves them automatically. So those ones will be marked. Yes. So I'm not sure when you're starting again, it's what's going to happen. But the ones before it froze will be marked, will be there, saved automatically.
It freezes, and then when it comes back again, it doesn't start all over again. It continues where you left off.
Okay, what you can do right now, you can just send me an email. I shared my email address. Just send me an email so that I can send it to someone at ICT just to check what could be the reason. And then what I'm going to do when I receive that response, I'm going to share it on the chat so that it helps everyone who has the similar problem as you. Yeah.
Oh, okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Yes, the question reads as follows. Does UNISA have a certificate of conduct other than the line that appears at the bottom of academic record?
Thanks for the question. Though it's a my colleagues in the registrations question, but normally the college are the ones who give certificate of conduct through our colleagues in the registration department.
Oh, I just have a question, I think, to Ms. Mandisa, and I'm not sure who else. My first question is regarding the Invigilator app. I downloaded it on my phone, but I'm having issues regarding registration. I put in all my details, but every time I click register for it to register my email, my MyLife email and all of that, it says my email has not been registered with my institution. So is there someone that I can send an email to that can help me regarding that? And then my second question is regarding the Invigilator app again. Ms. Mandisa said that after you scan the QR code, you put your phone on flight mode. Will I still be receiving notifications within the app during that off flight mode part, or do I have to, towards the end, switch it off again so that I can scan my script and upload it on the Invigilator app? Thank you.
The issue of the flight mode, it's according to what our supply had suggested, that it works even if it's on flight mode. So you will still get the prompts. So I don't know, because I have not practically done it, but it's what was suggested, that should be on flight mode so that you don't get disturbed by the anyone who's not in your space of writing an exam. So anything that has to do with the app, like if an app is prompting you to take a selfie or take a picture of your current exam page, then that one can still happen. What you're not going to be able to do is you receiving things from outside people. Then your first question was regarding the, can you remind me again?
Oh, it was regarding the registration on the Invigilator.
Oh, yes. You remember when you are registering, you also need to get a license, right? Maybe your at the time of registering, your name is not yet sent to the supplier so that they can link you to the Invigilator app system. But again, as I mentioned, it might be because you're not using an Invigilator app, or if you are using an Invigilator app and it's still giving you that that error, so it means you are to be given a license, meaning you are to send, call our contact center on 0800. I think I've shared the contact. Yes. You can just send, call there, or call those numbers, or send an email to Proctoring Inquiries. Then you can be assisted. Then it means you just need a license.
Okay. No. Can I
get a license?
And one last question quickly. I live in a very busy street with cars passing around and people, sometimes one or two people passing by talking and all of that. Will the Invigilator app pick that up, and will I be flagged regarding that?
Yes, Invigilator app will pick it up. It's because, remember, your microphone is on. But it really depends on the topic of what we hear. If we hear that it's just cars, it's just people from the street talking about their own stuff, or it's just your child coming back from school and greeting you, there's nothing there that says you are discussing the question paper. Yes, it will pick it up, but it will depend on what is that we hear before we can flag you.
Okay, thank you so much. I appreciate the specifically when it comes to the child one, because I live with a very busy child. So thank you so much.
No, it's not a problem. As long as you're not discussing the questions with your child, then it's fine.
Oh, no, he's still a toddler. Okay. So thank you.
All right. Okay, then.
Two questions in the chat regarding the Invigilator app. One is from Gosiame, which says, do we download the Invigilator app on the same device we'll be using to do the assessments or a different device?
Yes, it's the same device. It's the same. Remember, if you download it and then you want to use, I'm not sure if he's saying you want to use the same cell phone as where you download it, or I think someone said, or you need another cell phone. I don't know. But where you download it, you can still be able to write your exam using that cell phone. Remember, if you go to the LMS on the right top right hand, you'll see the LMS. Mm-hmm. Then you're going to click there, and then you're going to get your question paper there, and then you continue writing. That is within the app. So you don't need, if you decide to use your phone, there's no need of having two phones. You can still do everything there.
On the Invigilator app, TAM2601 says it's listed. However, on the UNISA tool for the proctoring tool, it does not reflect.
It might happen that you can find it here, not find it there. But you must look at what is on the timetable. What is your platform, my exam platform, saying when you're going to the timetable? Is it proctored? First of all, is it a proctored module? You can just phone and ask if this is a proctored module with what, because some of the modules you'll find out last year, before the Moodle proctoring, like the MCQs. Most of these modules are MCQ modules. Then you find out last year we used the Invigilator app to proctor this module. And now this year it has moved to Moodle proctoring. And when you go to that link to check if it's proctored with this proctoring tool, and it's not there, especially the ones that were using the Invigilator app, they are not there on that proctoring tools link. So it's very important now to check at what your timetable is saying about the proctoring tool that you are using.
So the question is from Mahabane, and it says, I wanted to know, how do I check if I have been admitted for an examination?
Students will know if they are admitted to the examination when they receive communication from us, mm-hmm. as the university. They mm-hmm. will get an email on their MyLife with their examination timetable as well as the rules for the particular examination.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much, Ms. Mata. Bonita,
also,
are you able?
Sorry, Chan. Yes. If, let's
yes,
say,
may proceed.
They, mm-hmm. if they have complied to the requirements that I spoke about, submitting one assignment or two OEMAC, and they see that they don't have qualification for a module, because on the timetable it will say not admitted, and once they mm-hmm. see not admitted, then they can send their inquiries to exams@unisa.ac.za so that this matter can be investigated to find out why they didn't get exam admission.
Okay,
and they
thank
should
you.
Do it now, because remember, I said on the 7th, we are starting with the short learning programs and then formal examination starting on the 14th of October. So they must inquire now, so that if there are issues to be sorted, they can be sorted out now, because some modules will be written early in the examination. And if you inquire late and already the paper has been written and we find that you do qualify, you were maybe excluded for one reason or the other, then you will go to the next opportunity.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you so much, Ms. Martha, for answering that question. Bonita, are you able to unmute?
Yes, I am. Thank you so much. And good afternoon, everybody. My question is for Ms. Mandisa. Actually, I have three questions. They are short questions, but my questions are for Ms. Mandisa. I just want to find out regarding calculations. So in some of my modules, you know, there are tables that are given, and usually I would do the calculations on Excel. are we allowed to use Excel to complete calculations during the exam, or use a piece of paper? How is that handled during the exam?
I think you will get the instructions on the question paper on how to do your rough work or your calculations. I don't know if you are allowed to use Excel for your calculations, honestly.
Okay,
but
so
instructions
we'll receive
on your question paper. Sorry?
So we'll receive clarity on that if there's calculations required.
Yeah, no, I won't know the content of the question paper at all. But I do know that there will be instructions from your lecturers as to how you need to do your calculations. I'm not sure if you are to use Excel, though.
Okay, and are we allowed to make notes during our exam? So I know, you know, when we're taking our photos and so on, are we allowed to have like a blank piece of paper that we take notes on?
To be quite honest, I don't know what is that you are allowed to do whilst you are writing your exam. What we want to see is you not doing anything suspiciously cheating whilst you are writing your exam. As I say, all these questions would be maybe directed to your lecturer as to how you should be doing your notes. Because remember, I don't even know if the module that you're writing requires you to do some notes outside that you are. For an example, let's just say it's an MCQ and you want to do your calculations. I can't really tell you how you should do your calculations. I think it will be there on your instructions.
Okay, and then my second question is relating to the Moodle application. When you download the application on your phone, it asks you to enter your site or to scan a QR code. Which site are we supposed to enter there, or where do we find the QR code to scan on this application?
On the Moodle application?
Yes, on the mobile application.
On the Moodle proctoring.
Yes, that's right.
The one for MCQs.
Yes.
Okay. That one is already there. Remember, it's already in your you're going to use your on my exams. You go through the site, your my exam site, your exam portal, and then like you normally log in using your details, I think it's your student number and something, email address, I don't know. But whilst you are in that page, it's going to give you instructions on what to do. You just upload your picture.
Okay, so actually we don't need the mobile app. We could just use the links and so on UNISA's. Okay.
Yes, you don't download it separate, that one. That one is already there. On the Moodle system.
Okay, perfect. That answers all my questions then. Thank you so much.
Okay, then. Thank you.
With regards to the exam qualification, I've been qualified to write 3 exams already, and those are my only exams. But I still have queries on assignments for all 3 modules, and I've repeatedly sent emails to the professors, but I haven't received any feedback yet. For example, for my TEM 2601 and SCD as well 2601, certain questions were not marked on my question papers, on my script that I submitted, and I've repeatedly sent emails to ask them to mark them or perhaps let me know if they are actually incorrect and they just forgot to put an incorrect mark there. So I don't know who do I contact further, because now I'm going to write the exams and then my marks will be calculated for the year. I don't know, who do I contact then?
Ideally, the lecturer is the one who is supposed to respond, as the student is clearly stating that her concerns are that some of the questions are not marked and there is no explanation. So if she has already sent the email to the lecturer and there is no response, I can just ask you to send an email to me, and then I will still do the same, maybe follow the same process, send it to the lecturer and ask the lecturer to respond to you, because I cannot assist with content. We only assist students with administrative support. So maybe if it's coming from us, the lecturer will be able to see its seriousness and respond, because as a student, you are entitled to get feedback properly. And if something is not marked, the lecturer at least needs to write on your script what is the reason for that piece of work not being assessed. You are entitled to get all your answers assessed, and if where the lecturer maybe doesn't agree or it's irrelevant, he needs or she needs to indicate something. So I did send my email address, I will send the email, my email address or the assigned email address. If you send your email there, and then we will just do what you have done and then see if we can get the response from the lecturer. We will CC you. So once the lecturer responds, you always also see what the lecturer has said. That's the least we can do, or the most we can do.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, I wanted to check, because I've been trying to see on some of my modules, which apps are we using? I've seen some that have indicated that we use the Invigilator app. Some haven't mentioned anything. So yeah, that's one of the challenges. And one other thing regarding that app, do I download it on the laptop or on the phone? Because I believe I'll be using the laptop most of the time. So if I tried it on the phone, it didn't work. I experienced the same challenges like the other people have mentioned, that it's not, my email is not registered, even though I use the UNISA email. So I wanted to know if I have to download it on the phone or on the laptop. And secondly, I'm trying to check this my exam thing. We are being told that we have to open we access the Moodle app on the my exam. I tried to look for it on my UNISA, I can't find it. I searched for it, I can't find it. So where do I get this my exam link? Lastly, I'm also doing postgrad, and although it's not mentioned anywhere, but I believe we might be allowed to consult our notes. But my question specifically is this: if I've done my preparation and I've done my own notes, and to save time, I copy from my own notes and paste on the exam, will that be considered cheating? My own notes that I've prepared, I copy them and paste them on my answer when I respond on the exam, on the exam answer book. Will that be considered cheating? Thanks.
All right, thank you so much for your questions. If I heard you correctly, your two questions are related to the proctoring tools, right? And the last question is related to the disciplinary matters. We yes. want to know whether it will be regarded as cheating or not.
Invigilator app. For Invigilator app, you can only download the app on your phone, on your smartphone, not on the laptop. My exams and the proctoring, Moodle proctoring, first you need to know if you have a module that will be proctored using Moodle in this exam. Because remember, you are to be linked in each and every proctoring tool. So your student number or the module that you're going to be writing, your student number must be linked there so that you can be able to access the page. So if you say you don't see it, it's my UNISA. It's when you are going to your my modules, you put in your stuff, and then, as I said, student number, I think it's student number and email address. And then you go through where you're going to see your modules and everything. If you are going to be using a Moodle proctoring, of course, there will be information about the Moodle proctoring because you will need to upload your picture. Unless you don't use any Moodle proctoring in your exam. I don't know if you are answered.
Yes. No, I'm answered. Then I believe the links will be provided as soon as
yes, they will be communicated. Yes, just check your communications from UNISA.
If I have prepared notes for the module that I'm writing, and I use the same notes to answer some of the questions, like maybe some of the questions that I prepared have come out in the exam, and I copy those notes and paste them onto my answers, will that be considered cheating?
Well, there are two types. Is it, what exam type is it? Is it open book or closed book? That's the first thing you need to first come to realization, and the exam rules will guide you. If it's open book, you use your own words and understanding and not copy verbatim, because that's copying and plagiarizing. And also, if it gets to be related or linked to other, it's like having an exam pack you are using, but you are not using your own ways and understanding. That's not originality. If it's closed book and you happen to use notes that are so similar, that is why my colleagues, when they were explaining things like invigilator and document comparison, that's where such forms of disciplinary cases originate from. You copy you from the same source, which another student or several students, you write the same thing, not in the same area. And yes, granted, you wrote alone, but because it was not your original work, one, and two, you were not supposed to have access, then automatically it doesn't even have to go for any other, because how is it possible that in a closed book, you, let's say, 2+ memorize the same thing word for word, verbatim, is not possible. So that's what leads to students being flagged. So you must read the exam rules, follow the exam rules, open book, closed book. Open book, what do the rules say? Not notes or no notes. No. Remember, you undertake to adhere to the university rules, not to adhere to your notes. So the exam university rules will guide you, and that will be in the form of exam rules. I think, I don't know if I've answered your question.
Thanks, Esther.
I'd like to please ask for especially closed book or any for that matter, since the Invigilator app will be taking videos of you, if one needs the bathroom, should you take the laptop with the camera with you to the bathroom to prove you're not cheating, or what should one do if they need the bathroom?
Invigilator app doesn't... I'm thinking you're talking about Iris, that we can be able to see you going to the bathroom. Remember, even if you can just stand and walk to the bathroom, we can be able to see you. But you can just tell us that I'm going to the bathroom, and that's it.
Okay.
There's nothing wrong. But you won't take your laptop to the bathroom. Of course, we don't want to see you in the bathroom. Because remember, if you're taking your laptop there, it means we are also going to be able to see you while you're doing in the bathroom. And we don't want that. Leave your laptop where you are, to your writing desk, station, wherever. And then you can just tell us, I'm going to the bathroom. Then you go to the bathroom. We can even tell the minutes that you stay in the bathroom. Because okay, we'll be reviewing your videos. Yes.
Thank you. And so do we download both iOS and the Invigilator app?
No, we don't. You don't. Because remember, Iris is used by CSET, unless you're doing CSET modules and CTA modules and, School of Accounting, few modules. But if you are in College of Education, Law, whatever, you only download the Invigilator app.
Okay, and you just say verbally, I'm going to the bathroom.
Yes, you just say verbally, I'm going to the bathroom.
All right.
Not to the Invigilator app. The Invigilator app, remember, we don't see you, but we can just hear what you're saying, but we don't see your face. So on the Iris, because we can see them going to the bathroom. So I'm thinking that a person who is worried, because when they leave without saying anything and they think that he's meeting somebody somewhere to take some notes or something. No, if you're going to the bathroom, you're allowed to go to the bathroom. You just verbally say, I'm going to the bathroom. We can hear you and we can see you going, but we don't want to see what you're doing in the bathroom while you're carrying your laptop there.
No. All right. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay. All right then. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Ms. Mandisa. There is a question here in the chat from K. Mavimbena. The question says, are all the exams handwritten and uploaded? And also, is the Invigilator app built in with the scanner?
I was responding to it and it's just, okay. I was responding to this one. No, Invigilator app doesn't have a scanner, but you have 10 minutes. You have 10 minutes to take photos of everything and upload it, and then the Invigilator app will automatically change it to a PDF, but it doesn't have a scanner. You will do it manually for 10 minutes to take those scripts, photos and everything else, and you won't be doing it. Invigilator app won't be doing it automatically. You
all right,
do
thank you
it
so
within
much.
A period of 10 minutes after the exam. And after if that 10 minutes lapses, then you can't do it anymore. Then it will look like you did not even use the Invigilator app.
Last time I was writing exam, and I was using Invigilator app, then the minute when I complete, I was doing everything right. Asking me to take selfie, copy of ID, and the where I am on exam. Then when I complete, when I'm supposed to upload the everything, the app keeps on saying uploading, until I report it to the Invigilator people via WhatsApp. But when they're supposed to help me, they didn't. I end up receiving the result of saying it's a supplementary. I must write a supplementary. Then I went to UNISA, to Florida to ask them about this. They were asking evidence of what communication, then it was difficult for me to get it because I lost the phone after the exams. So I don't know why it was saying that. People say uploading, but they was not finishing it.
It can be a network issue, especially if it happens at the end of the exam. And yes, you are to contact that 073 number, WhatsApp helpline. And what happens there, it's they are to, if it happens that you can't do it yourself, they're supposed to do it themselves from their side, but I'm not sure what happened in your case. So you are saying you've lost your phone, hence you can prove. If you can send me that the email and state what happened, because definitely sure they are able to check from their server if there was ever a query of that nature reported on the day. So what was the module that you were writing, what date, and what happened, so that they can check maybe if they're still not lying somewhere in the cloud or something, I don't know.
And there is a question here in the chat. I believe this question has been asked multiple times, but it feels our students may probably have missed it. So the question says, it's from Maureen, and it says, please ask Ms. Mandisa to clarify how one can go about using the phone with the Invigilator app and the laptop at the same time, just in case I'm not given a chance here.
With the Invigilator app and the yes. You know, are you going to be writing using your Invigilator, I mean the phone, or using the laptop? You download your Invigilator app on the phone, but you're not going to go on LMS to try and get the question paper on the phone. Then you are going to go through the link to get to your laptop. You know, you go to My Exams and then using your own details and then get to the page, that landing page, and then look for your module and continue writing. But your phone must be near you, so that if it says, remember the phone is for invigilation, that's basically what it is. So you must look for those prompts, because if they're saying now take a picture of something, you must be able to take that picture. That one is going to the Invigilation app, but you can access your question paper on both your laptop or your phone. I'm not sure if I'm answering it right or I got it right, but it doesn't mean you are going to use them. It's only the question paper that is there on the laptop. The same question paper, if you want to use phone, you can also get it on your phone. But your phone must be in front of you so that all the prompts from the Invigilator can be able to see them. If it says take a selfie, you will take your selfie using your phone. But you can be able to see question two on your laptop. Am I making sense? I don't know if I'm making sense, but it's something like that. It's only for the question paper. And then you lose your phone for proctoring purposes. I'm not sure
if
one gets it, but yeah, it's like that.
So my question, I wrote it in the chat and it was answered, but I am still experiencing it. So my question, it was, I am trying to log in through the Invigilator app, but it keeps telling me that I need to get confirmation from UNISA.
I think I did mention that you will need to get a license. So please call that number, 0800 number, so that they can be able to grant you access.
Okay. And another question. So for example, the closed book exam, you would still need to use the Invigilator app. So the exam is for 48 hours. So does that mean the Invigilator app should be on for 48 hours?
The exam is not for 48 hours. The time for you to submit your Invigilation results is 48 hours.
Oh, okay.
Yes, separate of 2 days. So what happens is the system will detect everyone who has scanned the QR code, right? When you're scanning your QR code, but you have not submitted your Invigilation results. So you are going to be reminded via the SMS and an email through your My Life email address within a period of 48 hours. And then if you will do it after 15 days, then you will be deemed as somebody who has not used the app, because the period of 48 hours for you to submit everything has lapsed.
And lastly, I wanted to mention the one of UNICEF's way of helping our students. We have our student mentors. These are our senior UNICEF students, undergraduates, postgraduates, honors and master's students who have come forward and have dedicated their time to assist their fellow UNICEF students in their journey. So they do give assistance on module-related topics, colleges and everything else. So if you still feel like you were not really able to grasp the content of today, please do apply for the student mentorship. The link will be provided shortly. And our student mentors will reach you and help you out. Whatever help you think you might be in need of, whether it's general or it's related to a certain module, how to prepare for the exams and so on and so forth. And also how to get yourself ready for the exams. They will share tips as they've been there before. So please do apply for the student mentorship program. It's for free. As long as you're a UNICEF student, you don't have to pay anything. Thank you for that. Before we call it a day, I'd like to call our last speaker of the day to officially close the program for us. Our last speaker of the day is our TCGP, that is Trainee and Career Guidance Practitioner from the Sunnyside campus, Ms. Nhloro Basechana, to close the workshop for us. Ms. Nhloro, over to you.
Thank you so much for that, Program Director. As we have come to the end of our first part of our exam prep workshop, I would first like to start by expressing our heartfelt gratitude to everyone who made this workshop a success. To the program director, of course, thank you for steering this ship so well. And to the speakers as well, thank you for making this experience so enriching and making sure that our students are ready for the upcoming exams. I have no doubt that the students are going to leave this workshop feeling confident in how to navigate through the various assessment types as discussed by Ms. Nyandeni, and also to Ms. Masiza for showing us how to correctly make use of the proctoring tools, which form an important part of exam matters, which was also discussed by Mr. Mudika. And also thank you to Mr. Mugubedi for highlighting the consequences of non-adherence to proper exam etiquette. Just a wide thank you to all the speakers for also taking the time out to address all the individual questions and queries. Lastly, to our students in attendance, thank you so much for joining us today. And we do hope that you can join us again for the second part of our workshop taking place tomorrow, which will be tackling more topics to further assist you in your preparations for your upcoming exams. With that being said, we have officially come to the end of our program. I hope you all have a beautiful and productive day further.
Thank you so much, Ms. Basechana. Thank you, colleagues. That's it from our side. Thank you for coming. See you again tomorrow, same place, same time. Bye.